stronger heroes won out in that game.
Yeah, absolutely. And while we're getting set up for this next map, just a reminder, folks, check out the Heroes Hype Patreon at patreon.com/heroeshype. Pledge your support and help them do all the cool things that they do for the Heroes of the Storm amateur community and for the HTC Open Division. All that money getting thrown back into all the events they put on at lands like BlizzCon and other such places. And subscribe to the channel as well. You get all the cool Heroes Hype emotes as well, and all that money just going right back in to the Heroes Hype community and helping them do more of what they do best, which is bring really good Heroes of the Storm content out of a really strong, really cool community. So make sure you guys check that out as well. Check them out on all their social media platforms. You can scroll down to the bottom of the page. All the panels have the links there ready to go. But we're going to talk a little bit now about the game coming up. It will be Tomb of the Spider Queen, picked by Necrodancer. So Psystorm will have first pick again here in game number two. And from what we've seen out of them so far, I feel like that is probably something that Necrodancers are going to have to be a little bit careful about, because we've seen Psystorm have some very strong drafts so far.
Yeah, definitely. And this map, once again, plays right into their brawly type nature. It's a small map, quick rotations. Kind of like we saw on Infernal Shrines, where they ran the Asmodan stack. This is like the map that made it famous. So, gotta look out for that Asmodan Johanna once again. Really strong as well because of how the points work. The Asmodan Q can actually hit anybody that is channeling from any direction on the shrine, as long as he focuses it on the center. So, really important for the shrine control that they can make sure they have that control. We are getting the readies in chat. This was Necrodancer's pick, so it should be Psystorm leading the draft once again for bans. Man, I'm just, that last game was so wow. Like, those end fights were just so long and drawn out. I just didn't know when it was going to end, because both teams had so much healing and shielding. It just, when is someone going to die?
That's the thing, again, with the sustained type damage output from the side of Necrodancers with their draft. You just don't have that sudden burst ability to make a player disappear from play for 45, 50, 60 seconds. So first of three bans on the side of Psystorm Gaming about to come in here as we get set for Tomb of the Spider Queen for game two of this round of 16 match here in the HTC Open Division North America Cup number 5.
Yep, and once again, it is going to be Psystorm having the first ban here. Three bans, once again. We've seen them ban Dahaka. We've seen them ban the Genji quite a bit. I think last game we saw them ban the Uriel. I think, or maybe it was the side of Necrodancers.
Really, it was Necrodancers that banned Uriel last game.
All right. But it is going to be first ban coming out. 0 seconds in. Medivh, okay. That's right. I always forget Domo's on the other team. This is another Medivh map. Like, you gotta get rid of it. Asmodan instantly gone.
Yeah, so two respect bans coming out from either side here as the Medivh against Domovarian and the Asmodan against, I believe it was NSJ playing Asmodan last time. Although I could be wrong, I should be taking notes as well. Amateur caster night here on the HTC Open Division. Really interesting, though, to see what comes out of the second ban phase. And this is the cool part about the three bans now, is that you have the opportunity to target ban a hero from the opposition that they're really well known for, and you can still come back with another meta ban as well to really shape the direction of the draft before anybody makes a pick.
Yeah, exactly. And we actually see that Alexstrasza, who in general has just been above and beyond really strong right now. Lifebinder is such a strong ultimate at keeping one person alive, or herself. It's just because of how it heals.
Mm-hmm.
First pick, Genji. You haven't seen Shimada Brother all night.
Well, Genji, yeah, Genji's been banned pretty consistently, and no surprise, very good about getting into the back line there. With Urel being banned on the side of Necrodancers, and again going into the Blaze Deckard priority in that first rotation, I'm still a little hesitant to support that one. We saw some really good Deckard play on the side of Necrodancers. There were some big Stay a While and Listen casts out there, but they just didn't quite have that follow-up, and that's what we talked about with their DPS picks. They don't have that burst to be able to really get full value from that long crowd control. Diablo and Rhaegar coming out. The Lurkablo skin obviously going to be played by Stronger on this rotation as well. And I'm thinking that Psystorm just have something in their pocket for this one. Seeing Genji come out, we know he's good at getting into the back line, looking for those finishing picks, very similar to how Zeratul was playing last game in the hands of Enivir. So we'll see how this last round of bans will shape this draft, but it's almost the same three bans out of Necrodancers. They take Urel and Phoenix off the board with a target ban on Asmodan.
Yeah, and unfortunately, I'm not the most familiar with Psystorm just yet. I saw most of the games last week. I'm assuming that is something that the side of Necrodancers has picked up either in scrims or in their research upon the team. Phoenix, though, being pretty heavily banned. I do know Phoenix works really well with Diablo's Lightning Breath with the Purification Salvo because of the bonus damage. Actually, wow, gonna see the Zeratul ban coming from the side of Psystorm, making sure they don't have that quick source of burst that they had last game.
Well, I'm not surprised to see that. They've already picked up the Genji. I would expect to see Enivir on the Genji. I don't have a ton of intel on the individual players, but given the composition style that we saw out of the heroes he's been playing in the last few games we've been watching, the Genji being gone. Although it's Rainer Stitches here, Stitches will get through the ban phase and will be played on the side of Necrodancers. So they don't feel they're going to be too worried about Stitches wanting to play with that hook and the give him some pepper on the side of Rainer coming in for Necrodancers.
So I want to call it now. If Psystorm doesn't pick Thrall here, Necrodancers will take it on the next round. It was their go-to pick with the Stitches. We are going to see Chromie, and it looks like we're going to see Sonya. So they're looking for someone that can help deal with the Thrall. And Chromie obviously having that really strong poke. But like I said, if we see that Earthquake game once again with the Thrall and the Rainer, the level one talent, Ace in the Hole, is so monstrous when the enemy team is permanently slowed. One second, 0 seconds. What's it gonna be? And it's the Thrall. In before, I called it. Going with it.
Your intel is good, and I have to feel that this one looks like it's right in the Necrodancers' alley. They've got the synergy that they're looking for. They're strong frontline in Thrall, Stitches, and Blaze, and with the Rainer backup, the Decker Kane crowd control, it's really going to be, I think, on NSJ on Chromie to try and disrupt that backline, make sure that they have to retreat, that they don't have the ability to follow up effectively on that frontline engage that we're going to see out of the side of Necrodancers.
And at the same time, Chromie is actually one of the easier targets to hit with a hook. Her Sandblast is a dead giveaway from where she is standing, and it's almost like a self-stun and how it works. So the hooks, we got to watch out for those hooks coming out, though. Gonna see probably Blaze in the offlane once again. But I escaped a lot differently than the first. So, game number two. Best of three. It is Necrodancers versus Psystorm. On the blue side, we have Necrodancers. It's Physicals on Thrall, Azariel on Blaze, Huff Money on the Stitches, Quantum on the Deckard, and Domovarian on the Rainer.
And on the right side, up a game in the series, it is Psystorm Gaming, NSJ on the Chromie, Caesar Salad on Rhaegar, Enivir on Genji, Hyskoa on Sonya, and Stronger is Diablo once more.
And we're going to see the Blue Sapphire, actually. Blue Sapphire gem out of Quantum. It's been a very popular pick lately. The extra 30% slow on his Hereditary Cube is monstrous. It's heroes that don't have a dash when you're going to have like a Rainer having permanent uptime on you.
It's slow type effects are so effective for Rainer. Just let him stay in range, get a lot of effective damage coming in with the head being able to stand there and poke. And we just see the quick rotations again coming out from Psystorm. Sonya already up to the top lane, and three heroes already in the bottom lane. Azariel taking a ton of damage. NSG getting that sandblast. Enivir not gonna go in. He does get it with the auto attack over the wall. Blaze gets confirmed as the first kill under a minute. And Psystorm with that rotation take first blood.
I don't know if you remember from our first series, but that's basically what happened to the Blaze over and over again on Cursed Hollow. So Psystorm taking a page out of the previous playbook, running it down at the enemy. Really good on them to flip kind of the meta on its head. We usually see the solo laner in the bottom lane, and they're deciding to rotate the four man up and down instead of up and down mid and bot instead of up and down mid and top. So good on them to kind of switch it up, make sure they take the momentum with them. Rainer, once again, ace in the hole, not stacking any talents to level one, so just poking out some damage. Doesn't really do much quite now unless he has someone acting up for them. Really, they just want to scale. That team doesn't take off for quite a while, whereas you have the Chromie, who levels up early and for talents, and a Sonya Genji. Like, that just speaks volumes of how strong their early game is.
You know what else speaks volumes about how strong the early game is? Rhaegar taking that camp pretty much solo in the bottom lane. So again, more pressure in the bottom lane with those Siege Giants here. Level 4 already online for the side of Psystorm Gaming, and all of this lane pressure coming in, that tower basically gone. And there it is. Here comes the rotation in from Necrodancers in response, looking for NSJ early on. A couple of flames, the Horadric Cube, the Chain Heal. NSJ is going to fall as there's just enough damage over time, but looking for a counterpick on Hoffmoney. Stronger's got him up against the fence there, and in the back line, Enivir looking for Quantum, but look at the healing output of Deckard Cain. All of those potions just able to keep him alive. Enivir just getting away. Never mind! The tower is a sniper, and that is a 2-for-nothing on the side of Necrodancers.
Oh my god, I didn't know Hots had a sniper tower hero. Oh my god. I saw that auto attack go, and I was like, no, he's dead! Oh man, phenomenal play coming from Necrodancers though. Taking that fight though, NSJ having a literal girl on fire moment, Blaze kind of running at her. Sonya though, doing what she can to get that experience back, a little bit of a lead inside of Necrodancers, which is where they want to be. Like I said earlier, they want to scale right now. They want to get as many stacks as they can, as many kills as they can. They want to take this lead and run with it. Rainer is so hard to deal with when you're trying to come from behind.
When Physical's getting those 21 gems off his Thrall in that top altar just before Enivir could sniff him out and try and interrupt that. That's a big turn in already there. As Caesar Salad again going for that solo camp pressure on the Rhaegar, as Enivir actually all getting a Feral Spirit in place there. We'll get away without too much trouble there as the two tanks going to town here. But the rotation coming in from the rest of the members of Necrodancers. Huffmoney with the hook, actually more of a dissuasion than anything, as they're going to continue this skirmish here with the spell shield from the bruisers as they push the mid lane back.
And Huffmoney basically shelling them, yeah, I'm a pretty good Stitches. You probably should have banned this hero again, because those hooks are on point. He is hitting them, he is causing disruptions. That's going to be a level 7 turn in, though. A lot of teams actually like to stretch it out a little bit, get as close to level 10 as they can. Try to get as many gems in the hole. Not really any of their lanes pushed out, though. All the Webweavers are going to start kind of middle lane. That is going to be a quick grab on a Stronger. He does have the quick dash away, though, with the minions still in play. Doing a ton of damage to Genji, though. It's taking that stun damage. Stronger going to get slowed, actually, and rooted. The slow keeps coming out. Gonna be another root. Rainer is sticking on him. Huffmoney getting flipped over, but Cain just healing him up, and he's so tanky on his own. Gonna take a ton of damage. The slide coming in, not able to grab him. He's gotta keep running. The root not quite making it. Huffmoney though, sitting at low HP. Gets the hook onto Caesar Salad. The slow comes out. They're trying to follow up on him. No root, unfortunately. Oh, Domo takes so much damage. The level 4 talent though coming in, get him the quick heal. Necrodancers having to back off. NSJ, we talked about it. The Chromie just has to poke and interrupt that backline, doing so much damage and forcing them to retreat.
And again, Stronger actually walking straight into this one. This could be devastating for the side of Psystorm Gaming. 26 gems about to fall here. NSJ has no opportunity to go in and try and recover those. And that is a well-timed hook on the side of Necrodancers, not only taking out the Black Soulstone, but the 26 gems, which would have equated to a turn in with some left over on the side of Psystorm right at the end of their Webweaver phase.
I hope somebody clipped that. Azariel hit Stronger mid Q with the jet propulsion. He interrupted the shadow charge, the point and click ability that is Diablo's engage. That is such a hard thing to pull off, yet Azariel doing it. Huff Money though, walking a little too close, gonna get trapped in this slow circle, gonna take a ton of damage. The jet propulsion coming in, the three man root coming in, Brawl is here, trying to do as much damage as he can. Heiska though, that whirlwind just keeping her healed up, not really too worried about it. Doing as much damage as they can. Domo taking a ton of damage from the Chromie combo. 24 stacks only for the side of Chromie. Not quite stacking very as quickly as she wants to. But they were able to pick up all of Blaze's gems, which is good news for the side of Necrodancers.
And remember, this is the Chromie before the rework that's happening on the PTR to that Q and to making Bronze Talon's baseline. So the Q able to stack up beyond the 60. But being at 20 right now, not getting a ton of those bonuses on that Q, so still a little bit of increased damage, but not enough to really make her a huge threat in these team fights yet, as 10 coming online for both teams now. No surprise seeing the Earthquake on the side of the Thrall, but Hyperion as well coming out for Domovarian on the Rainer, so really looking to maximize the damage output when they get into that Earthquake. But Lornado,
I'll tell you why. They want a Brawl. They don't need the big playmaker stun. What they want to do is get you in that Earthquake, get you in the Hyperion, and then keep you in there with the Tornado. It'll knock people away. It'll knock people forward. Here's the Earthquake. There's the Hyperion. There's the bunker. Everyone inside. Everybody get in. It's a party. It's lit in here. Huff Money running it down. The Putrid Bile doing so much work. Two kills on a Diablo and the Rengar, negating the worth of this turn-in. And like I said, that's exactly what they wanted to do. That Lornado keeping them in, not letting them escape once they're there.
How do you beat a Brawl composition, Dunkstick? Have a better teamfight composition in a closed space. And that's exactly what Necrodancers are doing. Psystorm have shown they love to dive. They love to get in your face and Brawl. Now when they do that, Putrid Bile, Lornado, Earthquake, Hyperion, all these great area of effect dissuasion abilities to really punish that heavy dive composition on the side of Psystorm.
And you see the level 12 coming out now for the side of Necrodancers, trying to get that race to 13. They need to catch this wave bottom. Physical is actually taking a ton of damage. But overall, Necrodancers showing why this composition works for them. This is their composition. You don't really see teams running this together. Huff Money actually grabbing Caesar Salad, getting the Putrid Bile. There's the Lornado. Get back here. Jet propulsion. There's Domovarian coming in. Stronger trying to use that Lightning Breath to deter them. Azariel taking a little bit of damage from the Chromie, only 50% of HP. But look at that team fight. And that's the power of the Lornado right there.
I am not really surprised to see it. We've seen a lot of great play out of players with the Lornado in weeks past, where they're just able to do so much disruption to opposition players when they get into that team fight. It's a blue Webweaver wave as they push in here. Their lanes are pushed back a little bit. That bottom lane, the Sea Shine, is doing a little bit of work getting past that fort. So Azariel is going to have to do some work pushing that back out. But I can really see Necrodancers focusing this top lane, trying to get that fort down, get a little bit more extended vision in the lane if they want to make a boss kill later on. As a Huff Money getting grabbed by Stronger there. Lornado will actually come in and just disengage here. Not really
only
looking
a
for that 40
second
right
cooldown
now.
By the way, only 40 seconds.
Such a good heroic.
Yeah, and they're gonna go ahead and run it down mid. Obviously, this is North America. Gotta copy you, Europe. Ezreal making sure he gets that value down bottom. The lanes were pushed out, unfortunately not in their favor, so the spawn of the Webweaver is pretty far back. But they are going to get this mid fort, tie up the forts. It is still level 13 to level 12. They want to try and pick a fight here. Stronger actually kind of far out. Huff Money trying to sniff him out, trying to force him kind of to take a fight. There is 13 talents now. He's going to get the Shadow Charge, stacking it up. The Unstoppable is coming out. He's going to get the Lightning Breath. There's the X-Blade. Hendavir actually going to back off. Physicals throwing down the Earthquake. The Bunker, though, doing a ton of work. Tough Money trying to do what he can. Unfortunately, not going to get a lot of value. The Bunker actually taking up a lot of space. But Hyperion value, going to take the Outer Wall. And they did take a bottom four with through the Web Weavers. So overall, quite the big experience swing for the side of Necrodancers. And they're not stopping.
Yeah, critically too, they have almost enough gems for a turn and really just need a couple more waves to be able to turn in again at 60 gems here, whereas Psystorm, after losing those 23 gems early on, kind of put back and still needing to build up back towards that second turn in for them here. So there's a big window of opportunity as well with this two-level lead for Necrodancers to really snowball this into an unstoppable momentum shift in their favor.
Quite enough gems for the side of Psystorm for the turn-in. But they are going to turn in as many as they can right now. Heiska getting the last 20. So only four more left to turn in. But we now have 60 on the side of Necrodancers, taking the mid camp too. So trying to make sure, actually going to grab Stronger, doing a ton of damage. Look at his health. There's the Ancestral. The Lord Nato pushing him into the towers. There's no escape. Putrid Bile coming out. Huff Money doing what he can. The Root coming out, looking for the hook. Does he have it? Not quite. What a kill. And that's going to give them the pressure to turn in, totally interrupting the process and resetting all the stacks on Diablo. That's huge for the side of Necrodancers.
And again, it comes from Stronger going in, looking to engage and getting immediately DC'd completely out of his ability to try and pull somebody out of position. That's the problem with the positioning right now for Necrodancers. They're very concave with how they're setting up so that anybody who dives in just gets collapsed by everybody else on the side of Necrodancers. It makes it really hard for Stronger to go in, try and pull somebody out of position because he doesn't have the ability to escape with how many roots and stuns come out.
Yeah, and you saw it right there. The Lornado came out and just totally negated any possibility of a Shadow Charge. Consistently trying to use it and just getting knocked back over and over again. We are going to see them kind of move up on this. There's the hook, Stronger. Going to get the Unstoppable, waiting for the Root to come out. There's the Earthquake. He's going to fall so fast. That's a level 16 Rainer and Thrall. The damage just pours out. That's a mid going down already. They're going to go ahead and back off. They have all the pressure in all the lanes. That last one's going to come. They're just going to burn boss. No Diablo for another 18 seconds.
Great call. They've got so much auto attack damage from Domo Varian. Look at the health bar on the boss going down. There is nothing that Psystorm Gaming is going to be able to do to stop this one. They're going to have to go full defense as Diablo comes back. They'll scout it out with the Time Walker's pursuit, but there is nothing they can do in response. They're just going to try and turn in here. Denivir is going to try and get Web Weavers to counter this push a little bit. Actually, no, he cancels the turn.
He's actually just delaying it a little bit. He wants the Web Weaver to spawn right on top of the keep, if possible, so they can protect the Web Weaver from the boss.
Actually, I think he was trying to get the siege camp timing done, but you can see that they've bailed out of this one immediately, although I'm going to get caught there. Didn't get out in time. The Hearthstone get just in the way from the fishing hook of Stitches, but Physicals on the Thrall coming in looking to engage. This could be devastating for Psystorm's. Heiska trying to get away, losing health. There's Caesar Salad with the save as the pursuit will be given up by the members of Necrodancers. But great awareness to recognize that turn-in was being delayed to try and get the siege camp. They rotated in immediately and almost got a pick as a result.
Yeah, and now they get to free clear the Web Weavers, unpunishing the turn-in right there. They had to turn in, unfortunately. You know, can't deal with that boss without a Web Weaver in that lane. But not going to get any value. Bottom lane is on red side. Mid lane's on red side. And this... Wow, that hook on the end of here, the stun. Nisapo comes out. But what a hit. Going to go ahead and just go ahead and clear this Web Weaver. Domo taking a little bit of damage. Just getting a little tickled by the Chromie. Still no 60 stacks for the side of Chromie. Really needs to make sure he gets these last 8 stacks if they want to stand a chance in these later fights. 18 to 16 though, only 2 keeps left. The mid keep is down. Catapults. Hyaska getting caught. We're going to see the Ancestral. Is it going to get there? Does get there. The Lornado trying to do what he can. X-Strike coming out. Domo though, unkillable. The shields and the heals coming from Kane. Anivir trying to run away. The slow is so huge. Not going to get the hook. Dash comes out. We do see the Rengar falling in the mid lane now. Three for none. Level 19 to 16. Look at Domo going for Anivir. The dash is out. Does he go back down? Nope. We're just going to go mid. No Hyperion to end the game, but they're 20 seconds on Sonya and Diablo. They're going to go ahead and start hitting the core. It's just Genji and Chromie. Domo doesn't even care. The root coming out, they're going to go ahead and get him. Wow. Game number two, though, going to the side of Necrodancers, showing why they are a top three team, not letting Psystorm get that second win. We're going to game three. This is series number two. Necrodancers, GG.
This is a fantastic response game on the side of Necrodancers. They got the composition they wanted. The respect on the Stitches only valid for one game. They Psystorm letting Stitches through the second wave of the bans, and really, I think, got punished for that because of how on point Huff Money was with the hooks. And not even just with the hooks, but with the ability to position himself with the rest of the team so that every time he picked up a hero with the hook, he was able to get complete support from the rest of his team's line, where they just fell in on a hero and made sure they confirmed that kill right away.
Yeah, and looking at it, the amount of control they had to dodge all of Chromie's abilities. Domo got hit a bunch of times, but never at the point where they could capitalize it. And he would just walk away with his adrenaline rush, healing him up, and Kane throwing him potions. Chromie never finished her stack. Nearly, 15 minutes in the game? My thing's actually bugged. I can't see how long the game went. Never finished her stacks. And that's a huge source of her damage, not getting the echo from her level, her trait. So, I mean, only 39,000. Genji actually out-damaging the Chromie, despite Chromie being a poke hero.
Yeah, I'm not super enthralled by that Chromie pick out of NSJ. I understand the logic behind it. You're trying to force the backline of Necrodancers into a position where they have to retreat. But when you're not getting that burst damage landing, when you're not landing your hits, there isn't a lot that you can really do. And the level 7 talent out of Deckard Kane, I think, was a very big part of that. The Horadric Cube reducing the hero damage dealt by heroes hit by it for 30% for 4 seconds, really just kind of negating that burst composition on the side of Psystorm.
Yeah. And do we see Psystorm ban the Stitches again? Like, Huff Money, I mean, come on, Huff Money on that Stitches. That die was a hook god. And then, like, the Putrid Bile with the Hyperion, the Lornado. Man, that was absolutely insane, their composition. And we saw it last week take the game off Wrong Orc. It obviously has a lot of power. And, you know, there are some bans you can put out to deal with it. But when you let it kind of slide through draft like that, you're going to get punished by Necromancers.
I think that if you let Stitches through that draft, you have to be ready to play around it. And I don't feel like the composition that Psystorm had going out of that draft was going to play around that in any way, shape, or form. They were a dive comp through and through with Genji, with Sonya, with Diablo. And they were punished for that composition because they were right into a crowd control pick composition that Necrodancer is really, I think, got handed in that draft by Psystorm.
Definitely. We're going to Volskaya. Necro.